There's plenty of confusion and puzzles about entropy. Today, I would like to talk about exactly what is entropy. And one of the questions that give conflicting answers is, imagine in front of you, you have some physical system. I believe this comes from Shelley Goldstein. Mm-hmm. Like, let's just say you give this example, like a glass of water, right, for instance. And its physical state is clearly not completely known to you.
Mm-hmm.
But then something else appears to you. You can be an intelligent person, an angel, or what have mm-hmm. you. It gives you a much better approximation of this mm-hmm. glass of water than what you had before. Then the question is, has the system's, the glass of water, has its entropy decreased?
Mm-hmm.
So there are, broadly speaking, two answers one can give. One is, yes, obviously, because entropy has to do with the information of the system. So if you've gained information, mm-hmm. the entropy has changed. Then the other is, that's absurd.
Mm-hmm.
The entropy has something objective to do with the mm-hmm. system. So why would your information mm-hmm. about the system change its mm-hmm. entropy? Take it away.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. And you will get both answers from perfectly competent physicists, and they will be absolutely certain that that is the right answer. So, I mean, I think that the best way to start even thinking about that is you pose the question as, what is entropy? And I think that's a bit of a misleading question, because entropy is one of those words that's used in different senses. And I mean, we're used to that. It's not unusual. Like, if you open up a dictionary and, like, at a random page and point at any word at random, there'll probably be like two or three or maybe four different definitions. Very often in science, people will coin a new technical term because they want something to have a precise, well agreed upon meaning. And that's actually what Clausius did back in 1865, I think it was. He thought, okay, here's this important quantity that I and others have been batting around in thermodynamics. It's important enough, it needs a dignified name. And his rationale was, look, everybody studies the dead languages, right? We all know Greek and Latin, and so we don't want something like from English or German or Italian, because then it becomes sort of nationalistic words. So let's coin something from a Greek word. So he coined the word entropy from a Greek word for transformation, and he deliberately coined it to sound kind of like energy because it's closely related concept. If I had my way, we would respect Clausius and we would only use the word entropy in exactly the same sense that Clausius defined it. Okay, and that would be what everyone means by entropy. But historically, that's not what happened. There's been a number of different quantities that people call entropy, and they're all related in some sense to thermodynamic entropy, but they're just different things. If someone asks you the question, has entropy decreased? I think a natural question is, well, which entropy?
So in other words, there should be entropy sub 1, entropy sub 2, right, entropy sub 3. And when someone says, well, what is the entropy right of the system? Right. You say, okay, are you referring to 2, 3, yeah, sub 1?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Or, I mean, if I had my way, people would just have coined different words for these different kinds of things. But there's a reason why some people say, well, of course, entropy has to be an intrinsic property of a system, because, you know, this is physics after all. You know, we're not doing psychology. It's not we're not studying people's information. We're studying physical properties of physical systems, which they, you know, qualities they have no matter what anybody knows about them or would think about. Like, if I ask, okay, what's the mass of this cup? That, you know, it would seem absurd to say, well, how much do you know about the cup?
Mm-hmm.
Right? The mass of the cup is something that the cup has. I'm talking about the rest mass, because sometimes people will talk about relativistic mass and talk about that as observer dependent. But okay, what's the rest mass of this cup? Then, that's the property of the cup. And it doesn't matter what anyone thinks about it. And if you think that thermodynamics is a science like that, it is just studying the physical properties of things, then it seems absurd that one of its central concepts, entropy, would be something that would be defined relative to a state of information. And I think that at bottom, the fact that people are inclined to think that different notions of entropy are obviously the right one, and different answers to this question are obviously the right answer, is, even though this gets completely blurred in the textbook tradition, there are actually different conceptions about what the science of thermodynamics is all about.
Okay, so look, in the second law, it's stated that entropy doesn't decrease.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Yeah, your caveats, closed system or isolated system, right, and so on. Yeah. Okay. Then there's a formula for entropy. Are you saying that even here, there should be sub 1 and sub 2?
If you go, these different notions of entropy are actually defined differently. If you look at different textbooks, when they introduce the concept of entropy, they actually will sometimes give very different definitions. Right. And so maybe I should just talk about what Clausius was doing, right? You know, because that's one of the definitions that's out there, right?
Sure.
Clausius was working in the 1850s, 1860s. Those are the early days of what we now call thermodynamics. And it was Kelvin who gave the science that name. And I think a lot of people actually misunderstand what that word means, thermodynamics. Because in physics these days, when you talk about dynamics, you talk usually mean the laws of evolution, like, you know, the dynamical laws that govern the behavior of systems. And that's actually not what Kelvin meant when he decided to call this emerging science thermodynamics. This was, you know, as I said, back in the days when everybody studied Greek in school, and it's formed from two Greek words, the words for heat and for power. And thermodynamics has its roots in the study of how you can get useful mechanical work out of heat. Like, it really ultimately has its roots in Carnot's study of heat engines, efficiency of heat engines. If you think of that as what thermodynamics is about, physicists these days have a word for a theory like that. It's a resource theory. And this comes out of quantum information theory. So what happened in, really got going a couple decades ago is this, you know, field of quantum information theory. It includes quantum communication and cryptography and stuff like that. And they were asking questions like, you know, if you've got two agents who have access to certain resources, what can they do with those? So, for example, you know, these agents are always called Alice, Bob, and Bob, by the way. You know, for example, if Alice and Bob want to send a secure signal that an eavesdropper could not, as a matter of physical principle, eavesdrop on, what can they do? Can they do it if they have a certain amount of shared entanglement? So it's using physics in the sense that quantum physics is telling you how physical systems are going to respond to certain operations and stuff like that. But it's got all this, but the questions you're asking are really questions not within physics proper. It's questions about what agents with certain kind of means of manipulating a system and certain resources can do to achieve certain goals.
Why is that not in physics proper?
Because when I say physics proper, people usually, what I mean is, what physicists usually think about, physics is about the properties of physical systems, period. Right. And if I'm talking in a, and so these goals of these agents aren't a matter of physics. These are something that you're adding on.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. basically an extremely high-quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.